Well, a very uplifting jingle, and my good heavens, don't we need it. Today of all days, Thursday the 20th of October, which will be remembered for many reasons and no doubt will come up time and time again in the pub quizzes of the future. However, you are very warmly welcomed to tonight's Proactive Investors One-to-One Virtual Webinar, and we have two cracking companies tonight. Success stories and a stark contrast to our current government shenanigans. So, as usual, 20 minutes per presentation, 10 minutes Q&A, and that's where you, the audience, can get involved. You can, if you are joining us on this platform, put your questions in the chat box or the Q&A section, and I will endeavour to read them out. So first up, we've got our first company. It's got a market cap of £306 million. It's Tharisa, a platinum group metals and chrome co-producer, dual listed on the Johannesburg and London stock exchanges. It's had its best year on record in terms of output, and to talk to us about recent figures and hopefully an update on the Karo Platinum Tier 1 asset in Zimbabwe, I'm delighted to be joined by the Chief Executive, Phoevos Pouroulos. Phoevos, a very warm welcome to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah, and thanks for hosting us tonight. And welcome to all the viewers to this update presentation of Tharisa and what we've been up to. So for those of you that don't know us, we're an integrated platinum group metals and chrome concentrate co-producer. I think this is very unique when you look at our peers that are platinum group miners or chrome miners. They focus on the primary resource, and in some cases, they scavenge or as a byproduct, as an afterthought, really, they process either chrome or PGMs. I think what's important here is we have a successful track record. We've been in operations for over a decade, and this is really born out of the fact that we have a massive resource in South Africa. We're situated in the southwestern limb of the Bushveld complex, which hosts the majority, over 70% of the world's platinum and chrome resources, so chrome and PGM country. Our resource has an open pit life of mine of 20 years remaining. Thereafter, we've scheduled a 40-year underground mine. And this is really by the virtue of the fact that we mine the multi-seams of the Middle Group Reef Horizon. We do have a fantastic growth pipeline of increasing our platinum group metals, which we'll unpack later, and that's further north in Zimbabwe at the Karo project. But I think we've used technology and research and development to unlock value, perhaps where others overlooked opportunities, and the Tharisa mine is a point in case. I think we're very pleased to have withstood the cyclicality of commodity prices and been able to return value to shareholders for the past 6 years by being a consistent dividend payer. So when we talk about the culture or the ethos of our business, innovation is one of the core values that comes up. And the Tharisa mine is a point in case. It's the first time that the Middle Group Reef Horizons have been mined on a co-production basis for platinum group metals and chrome. Historically and conventionally, only two of the five seams are mined for chrome by some of our peers and competitors. But what we've done is we've optimized processing technology to maximize the recovery through various initiatives. And we've outlined them here really as markers and milestones of the development of this ethos. First of all, increasing the quantum of the specialty chrome concentrates that we produce. And these are premium products, so diversified away from stainless steel and globally diversified from stainless steel producers. The Voyager plant, which is the first of its kind, a fully integrated large-scale PGM chrome recovery plant. And then we introduced technologies to improve those efficiencies. But being as adventurous and as innovative as we are, we said, let's look at downstream beneficiation. And we've commissioned a 1 megawatt pilot DC smelter to beneficiate our PGMs further. So those of you that know, most junior or mid-tier PGM miners are locked into concentrate sale agreements with the majors that have refineries. And we're looking to break that convention and develop our own downstream beneficiation to capture additional margin. And then importantly, we have a very strong drive at looking at new applications and new uses for the commodities that we mine, and in particular, focusing on decarbonization of our planet. So fortunately, we've just released our 2022 financial year-end results, production results, those are, and it really, by all accounts, has been a fantastic year for us. Record performance on all fronts. Reef mined up slightly 2.8% to 5.5 million tons. So this is a large operation, the Tharisa mine, producing 179.2 thousand ounces of PGMs, up 13.6% from the prior year, and then producing 1.58 million tons of chrome concentrate, up 5.1%. When we look at the average PGM basket price, it looks quite low in contrast to the prior year, some 16.6% down, but still historically very high at $2,564 per ounce. And again, we need to couple that with the weaker South African rand. So in rand terms, you're looking at about 10% decrease in PGM basket prices year on year. But I think the standout really is the big jump in chrome concentrate prices, up 35.7% to $209 per ton for the year. We are debt-free, and we've ended the year in net cash positive position of $78.6 million, so a very pleasing position. But I think the two standout transactions that we concluded during the year and possibly maybe have flown under the radar were, first of all, we consolidated our minority BEE shareholders at the Tharisa Minerals mine level, and we converted those shares and we flipped them up into Tharisa PLC shares. And that was a truly empowering deal for our minority shareholders, where they now have exposure to the broad Tharisa group, have a liquid asset, and can benefit from our very healthy dividend policy and enjoy the benefits of that. And so that means that we've consolidated 100% of the cash flows out of the Tharisa mine. And you'll start seeing some marked differences in contribution to the Tharisa PLC listed company. The second deal, and we'll unpack this, it was hugely value accretive to shareholders, and that was the increase in our shareholding in Karo Platinum and Karo Mining Holdings. So if we just unpack the commodities, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of volatility in the world. The fundamentals of most things are being challenged at the moment in this hyperinflationary environment that we're seeing in Europe, possibly for the first time in many, many decades. I suppose fortunately and unfortunately for us, we used to volatility in operating in Southern Africa. Our exchange rate in particular is very volatile. So when we look at the fundamentals of the platinum group metals, we still remain confident, even with the overlay of economic uncertainty. And really what gives us comfort is the fact that these are precious metals and they're essential in their function and use. And today we see rhodium and palladium in deficit. In other words, there's demand outstrips supply. Coupled with that is the uncertainty in Russia and the war in Ukraine, and supply constraints coming out of the Russian territories. Russia supplying 38% of the world's palladium from non-nickel predominantly, and the certainty of that supply is in question going forward, multiple levels. And then platinum currently sits in a surplus position. However, most analysts, and certainly we believe that we will be heading into a deficit position within the next 18 months. And why do we come up with that conclusion? It's because primary supply is under pressure. Recycling of used cars, auto catalytic converters, is delayed by the fact that auto sales and demand has not been met with the semiconductor chip shortage. And in fact, the loadings to meet new emission standards are increasing. So all in all, we see very strong fundamentals in the short to medium term for the main PGMs. Internal combustion engines will still be the main driver, but the real silver lining here is the development of the hydrogen economy. And it's the first time that we're seeing policy capital and technology all aligning, and we're seeing huge projects being announced. And the net beneficiaries of the hydrogen economy are platinum and iridium, and to a lesser extent, ruthenium. So we're very well positioned to benefit from that increase in demand. When we look at chrome, it is a bulk commodity, and we're very pleased with the fact that we could export the majority of our chrome during challenging supply chain issues to predominantly our stainless steel customers in Indonesia and China. Tharisa mine, this single mine, accounts for around 10% of Chinese chrome imports. So a significant brand name within the stainless steel ferrochrome arena. And importantly, South Africa supplies 80% of China's chrome needs, be it in ferrochrome or chrome concentrates, which is what we produce, and they have no resources of their own. So a perfect nexus of supply and demand, and we see growth continuing in the Chinese economy in spite of the COVID, zero COVID policies, lockdowns. We've seen stainless steel prices being volatile, but demand being consistent. So you can see the price chart on the top right-hand side shows a very interesting picture, but generally trending upwards. Current spot prices in excess of $215 per ton. And this really is driven by the fact that port inventories in China have hit very low levels during this last year, to critically low levels of 2.2 million tons, currently sitting at 2.7 million tons. Is less than 6 weeks supply into the stainless steel industry. So very interesting dynamic there. Now let's move on to our exciting project to the north of us, Karo Platinum. So currently, Tharisa has invested to date in the form of cash and the share acquisition, which was a share conversion of Tharisa PLC shares, $70.3 million. And that in turn has given us 70% of Karo Mining Holdings, with 30% still held by Lito Settlements. That is a dilutionary holding by Lito, and we'll see Tharisa increasing its stake as it invests. So the funding to date was really for the first acquisition of 26.8% of Karo Mining Holding shares for $4.5 million, exploration and the technological studies at $11.4 million. And then we've kicked off the project, the development, so early funding of $25 million has gone into the project, not fully drawn down as we speak today, and then the share acquisition to the value of $29.4 million, getting an additional 39.5% shareholding. If we look at the structure on the left-hand side, you'll see that Karo Zim Holdings has 85% of Karo Platinum, and that is the license holder and the company that will be developing the Karo mine, and Generation Minerals is the government or the Republic of Zimbabwe with a carried interest of 15% equity in the project. So we're perfectly aligned with government's ambitions to open up business in Zimbabwe, to create employment, to create meaningful, sustainable economic impact. I think a question we get all the time is, are you going to continue to pay dividends while you have this ambitious growth in Zimbabwe? And the answer is yes. We have a stated capital discipline and a stated policy to pay 15% of net profit after tax in the form of dividends to shareholders, and we'll continue to do that. And I think our strategy is built on three pillars: growth, which is the Zimbabwe opportunity, the technology, the downstream beneficiation, continuous investment in our existing operations. We've seen what's happened when mines don't invest in sustained business capital, they get caught short, and then production declines, and then there's a huge capex requirement, and then returns to shareholders in the forms of dividends. So just to remind the audience, the second richest geological formation for platinum is the Great Dyke in Zimbabwe. It's a geological formation that runs from north to south, splits the country in two, and we're situated in the central chamber of the Great Dyke at Karo Platinum. It's a vast land package of just short of 24,000 hectares. And historically, this was owned by Zimplats, one of the major platinum producers on the dike, and they declared a resource of some 96.4 million ounces. In terms of our first phase and our phase development approach, we looked for quick-to-market, easy, accessible ounces, and that gives us the 10 million ounce resource that we've declared for our phase one open pit. So what does this mean in terms of impact investing? In a country that has very little employment and very little foreign investment, this has a significant impact. When we look at what we're doing on the ground, we are very excited by the impact that we will have, not only on the employees, but the surrounding communities and the economy in general. So we comply with IFC standards in terms of environmental approvals. We've got mining and processing approvals in place. We have access to water and electricity. And importantly, we have a dedicated upliftment, local recruitment and skills development plan. And in terms of our first phase, the relocation of inhabitants there is limited to 12 households. Importantly, we have signed an MOU with Total Eren to develop 300 megawatts of renewable energy, of which we will be a primary off-taker, and that being solar power. And then when we look at economics in terms of the contribution that mining has in Zimbabwe, it currently accounts for between 10 and 14% of the GDP. And Karo is set to employ around 1,000 direct employees. And then if you look at the multiplier effect, using a conservative 7 times, you're looking at impacting 7,000 households from this single investment, and potentially contributing 2% of GDP. So we've spent a lot of time over the last 6 months recosting the capital that goes into this Karo project, and also redefining the parameters of the throughput and output. And in this hyperinflationary environment that we're in, you can understand that things have changed and moved from our original capital estimate. But we're very pleased that we've got a firm capital cost with significant contingencies and escalation provisions in place to accommodate any fluctuations. But we believe that we've priced this at peak inflationary costs. When we look at iron ore prices halving from their peak, there potentially could be some savings. So direct CapEx, $301 million, with a significant contingency of $45 million on top of that, giving us a total CapEx of $346 million. Then working capital to first ore and mill, some $45 million. That's basically your mining development, run-of-mine stocks before you start processing. And then on top of that, Tharisa PLC, the parent company, has provided an escalation reserve of some $26 million to accommodate those unforeseen escalation costs that potentially could creep into the project. So the biggest question is, how do we fund this $391 million? So we're working on multiple funding streams. We will leverage our existing assets at Tharisa, partially leverage them to the tune of $130 million. That will come in via equity investment through the Karo Mining Holdings as part of Tharisa's investment. And then we're looking at a syndicated loan, which has political and economic, political and commercial insurance wrappers, export credit finance to the tune of $260 million. And then we're very excited about the bond listing on the Victoria Falls Stock Exchange. This is part of a special economic zone. It's the only US dollar exchange on the African continent, we believe. And this will be the first bond listed on the exchange. We've done preliminary non-deal roadshows, and there's a huge amount of interest from pension funds and institutions in Zimbabwe that essentially have trapped US dollars in the Zim economy with limited investment grade opportunities. So that we're hoping to launch at the end of October and close out before the end of November. So just touching on the special economic zone, the Karo project is situated in a newly zoned special economic zone, which gives us numerous economic benefits, tax holidays, the duty-free importation of capital goods, which is very important for us as we start developing and bringing capital goods into the country. But more importantly, it's envisaged to create an economic hub for our supply chain into the mine. So just unpacking the strategy and looking at what it is that the Karo-Tharisa combination looks like. And we talk about key strategic future supply. And this is important. When we look at the supply constraints coming into the PGM space. We see this investment as strategic, albeit through a very volatile, uncertain time. We certainly have the confidence to invest through this volatility. So if we combine the two resources together, in excess of 17 years open pit life, 7.5 million tons of run of mine to be mined from both operations, we'll be approaching the 400,000 ounce mark, so doubling our PGM output from Tharisa, in excess of 2 million tons of chrome. And based on consensus analysis and the attributable value of our shareholding in GFRD, this gives a value of approximately $1.3 billion. So significant in terms of scale, sustainability, and strategic supply going forward. So when we look at our ethos as a company, innovating the resources company of the future, we're very proud of the fact that we've delivered for the last decade successful cash flows, successful sustainable operations, and we've established a good track record. We have a diversified portfolio on track with Zimbabwe, coming on stream, importantly, within 24 months. So by the middle of July 2024, we'll have our first ore and mill. So it's a very short timeline. And unlocking all of this is the innovation and beneficiation aspects that we have embedded in our approach to projects. And then again, talking about growth and capital returns, growth, growing our production profile, as mentioned, to 400,000 ounces and 2 million tons, and sticking to our consistency of being a dividend payer. We've been paying dividends for the last 6 years. We've distributed over $50 million to our shareholders. And while our share price has dropped along with many other producers in this space, we still see huge value and huge upside. And when you look at the multiples, price to earnings at 2.7, and that certainly will come down on the back of our production results, NAV on an absolute value basis, 0.5, a dividend yield of 6.3%, EV EBITDA over at 1.3. So a compelling value proposition going forward. So with that, I'd like to close on our core values, just underpinning who we are. And I'll hand over to you, Sarah, for questions.
Many, many thanks indeed. So there you go. The company's withstood the commodity cycles. You continue to look after the shareholders. 6 years of paying dividends, and they are not going to stop. You've reinforced that message several times during your presentation. But something I absolutely love, right at the beginning, you talked about developing your own downstream. It's as though you're becoming a one-stop shop to avoid being locked into what could be punitive refinery and smelter contracts. So how are you going to fund that initiative? You've got $78.6 million to play with, but at the same time, you're trying to garner interest for Caro. So how are you, talk to me about the downstream business. What's the future? What are the timelines and how are you going to fund it?
So, that's a great question. Thanks, Sarah. So in terms of the downstream beneficiation, we have a facility, our R&D and beneficiation facility, where we currently operate our PGM smelter on a pilot scale. We're busy with the full front-end engineering and design for the full-scale complex, which is really, I suppose, a 10 times scale of what we're currently doing now. So same process, same methodology, but just a larger version of it. And that will be situated in proximity to the Tharisa mine for logistics reasons. And we're in process now with environmental approvals. So we assume that that process will take around 24 to 36 months. So it dovetails perfectly with the commissioning of the Caro Platinum project. And the capital, really, we estimate to be between $40 and $50 million. And we've had preliminary discussions with local lenders in South Africa, development banks, and they're all very interested to see beneficiation of commodities in South Africa. So we don't think there will be any challenge in terms of raising capital for that project. And importantly, it has a very short payback period, because if you look at the economics, we're chasing 15% of that $2,400 PGM basket price. And that's the reward, and that's after costs. So if you look at our output, you look at the capital, very short payback period for that initiative. So literally, we say it's a no-brainer.
I'm just wondering how far you're going to develop this downstream idea. So here in the UK, we've got a freight and logistics company called Eddie Stobart, or at least we used to. And so that was lorries on the roads, it was railways, it was airlines. So I'm just wondering, would you be considering going into taking this further into logistics and perhaps even opening your own insurance company and become a full one-stop shop?
No, so we do have our own logistics business, but we don't own any assets in terms of logistics. So they manage the flow of our commodities, and it gives us the flexibility to use various service providers, various freight liners, and various terminals. So through this last year, where we moved our cargoes, we opened up two new channels, one through Maputo in Mozambique, and another private port in Durban. So it allowed us that flexibility. So I think when it comes to our core business of being resources focused and metals focused, that's where we see the opportunity in terms of downstream beneficiation and the application of those commodities into new uses.
So what you don't have control over is inflation, which takes me to the first question from the remote floor. Trevor Phillips saying, has your labour and machinery costs significantly increased? Can you manage this increase? And I want to add this, which is diesel.
Yep. So at our half year results, you may have picked up in our numbers that we took the brunt of the increase in the oil prices, where with our diesel costs doubling on site. We're a big consumer of diesel, being an open pit yellow fleet miner. So the counter efficiency there is that we increased volumes and increased output. So on a unit cost basis, we managed to contain some of that inflationary costs. In terms of our labor agreements that we have with the multiple unions on site, we signed a four-year agreement 2 years ago, so we're halfway through that, and that was a historically inflation-linked increase. So it's a fixed percentage, and we do provide certain relief programs for employees that are struggling. Bearing in mind that we are a mechanized mine, on average we pay very well, and in fact our average pay scale is well in excess of the minimum requirements from most unions. So we do have a little bit of buffer there. But having said that, there's no doubt that that the man on the street is feeling the pressure of the inflationary environment. In terms of yellow fleet, we have a comprehensive replacement program, and our fleet is aged differently. So on an annual basis, we price with our OEMs in advance the long lead items and orders. So we try and lock in as much of that flexibility. But one of the biggest factors that you have to understand is that we're a Rand cost-based business. So with our commodities being sold in US dollars, we have almost a natural hedge and almost a buffer in terms of margin protection. So our Rand, as you may know, has devalued significantly since the half year, almost 20%. So that 20% in effect becomes a cost savings in dollar terms. So while we're not very popular at a dinner table conversation where we want our currency to devalue for these reasons, it certainly supports our business and exporters of commodities.
Your share price isn't being discussed at dinner parties either. It's currently at a three-year low, which takes me to Simon Smith's observation, which is, like many mining companies, your share price has dropped in recent months. Can you see a recovery in the share price given the backdrop of inflation, war in Europe, and general global uncertainty?
Look, the macro factors are creating uncertainty and anxiety amongst equity investors. We'd like to believe there are a number of catalysts that'll make potential new investors excited about the story. First of all, we have a robust business. Our margins, have, in spite of these increased costs, have remained robust. our business has shown resilience. So we have a very strong cash flow being generated out of the Tharisa mine, where we believe diversification and creating a second cash flow of significance in Zimbabwe will give us extra flexibility and versatility when it comes to risk mitigation. And we believe that as we progress, first of all, with our financials that will come out towards the end of this year, beginning of December, for the financial year in 2022, as well as the progress at the Kara project, we think these will be catalysts for some interest in the stock going forward, because like all other shareholders, I certainly believe we're undervalued and there's a great value proposition ahead.
Particularly when you pointed out that there's going to be a deficit of PGMs within 18 months' time, a year and a half. Now, that's quite shocking. So the quicker you get on with the Caro book build, the better. So you are hoping to hear about, is it how the bond or the book building has done by November? What's the process leading forward in terms of Caro?
Yeah. So we launched the bond, as I said, towards the end of October. It's open for a month. So by the end of October, we should have that bond concluded. And the other funding strategies are running in parallel. So it's all happening. We've appointed the bulk earthworks contractor on site, and they start clearing the site. We have a groundbreaking ceremony in December for the Kara project, which is a significant milestone. You can imagine we started the project, the exploration in 2018. And so we, within 6 years, we'd have our first production out of that, which if you look historically at the average time it takes to build a mine being 12 years, with COVID interruptions, it's a good time, we believe.
You're a very philosophical company, so let's talk about the investment philosophy within Zimbabwe. It's a volatile country. You've obviously factored this into your risk assessment. It would have been a big feature within the prospectus. How comfortable are you with proceeding project execution? What have you done in terms of making relationships at a local and a central government level?
Yeah, so first of all, we must remember that there's a very well-established mining community in Zimbabwe. The Great Tarc hosts three of the major platinum producers, Impala Platinum, Anglo Platinum, and Sibanye. And they've been operating there for decades through the dark days of Zimbabwe and continued operations with sustainable low-cost PGM ounces. So if you ask any of my counterparts at these companies, they say their best operations, most productive operations are in Zimbabwe. So there's a well-established mining code, mining ethics, skills within Zimbabwe. So we get great comfort from the fact that our neighbors to the south and to the north of us run very successful operations. Secondly, to de-risk our entry into Zimbabwe, we started with a very small investment in selenium chrome, Zimbabwe, where we established a very small chrome operation with a small scale chrome processing plant. And the idea behind this was to learn how to operate within the context and in the jurisdiction of Zimbabwe. So we've had boots on the ground, we've got camps, we've got employees, we've tested the special concessions that we've got for the special economic zone. We've engaged with all the various government departments, whether it's labor, whether it's VAT taxes and so forth. So we've built those relationships, not only at a high level, but at the grassroots ground operating level. And that's been the most value that we could have garnered over the last two and a half years on the ground. But importantly, the Zimbabwean government and ministries are very supportive of any foreign direct investment that creates sustainable employment. So we've been very well received. It's an enabling environment. They want to see this project succeed. And bearing in mind that they are shareholders and beneficiaries at an equity level, but as a country, as an economic contributor, this could be a significant asset for Zimbabwe.
So finally, the UK has been described as being uninvestable due to our current political climate. Are you still feeling confident about continuing with a London listing?
Look, I think the fact that our assets are foreign and potentially give some relief from the uncertainty and chaos that you're experiencing at the moment, perhaps is another investment proposition. We're not exposed to the UK economy, as it were, directly, or earn our income from the European economy at this stage. So perhaps that's something to consider. But we are dual listed on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange as well. So no reason for us to think about our listing in the UK. We're happy with it.
Many thanks, and good luck with the looking for the syndicated loans and the bond listings for Caro. That is significant news indeed. Really appreciate your time. Thank you very much indeed, Phoebus. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you, everyone. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Right to our second presentation of the evening, and it's Galliford Try, which is a construction group known for its divisions, which include Galliford Try, Morrison Construction, Oak Dry Lining, Asset Intelligence. There's more. And now the most recent results showed the company's cash generative with well-capitalized, debt-free balance sheet. Market cap today, £184 million. And as you can see, we're joined by the group finance director, Andrew Duxbury. Warm welcome to you, Andrew.
Thank you, Sarah. Good to be with you again. So, as you say, Sarah, so Galliford Try is a national contractor. We build the UK's social and economic infrastructure, schools, roads, water infrastructure. And this evening, I want to cover really three things. First, an overview of how we operate as a business. Secondly, just a review of the results and trading through to our June 2022 year end, and then a focus on our strategy and outlook. So the slide on the screen here really shows our philosophy for how Galliford Try operates. We call this our engine for sustainable growth. And we believe, in a sense, that all good construction companies would follow this type of virtuous circle. So it starts with the people, high quality people at the center of everything that we do. And then if you just start on the left-hand side there, we have a strong culture of discipline, of risk awareness. This is about making sure that we take on profitable work with good clients. And the key for our business is that contract selectivity, and that's driven by the culture of risk awareness, which is homogenous across the business. That in turn leads to a really high quality order book with good embedded margins, good cash flow. And that order book is largely run with repeat clients. 94% is with repeat clients, and also through long-term frameworks. And moving to the right, those long-term frameworks give us really good visibility of the pipeline of future work. That means that we're able to plan the business, get our resources in line, make sure we're able to really plan for what our clients are looking for over the next 2 or 3 years. And of course, in turn, that means that we can deliver strong, profitable contracts with good cash flow to help strengthen the balance sheet. And I'll come on to the balance sheet later on. And in turn, that strong balance sheet reinforces the culture of discipline, of contract selectivity, and so the cycle turns again. So that's the philosophy that's really driving the business. And we're starting to see that coming through in the performance of the business now, as I'll come on to. So we're a June year end. So the numbers on the screen there for the financial year through to June 2022. And you can see it was a really excellent year. Thanks first and foremost to our people, to our supply chain, to our clients, of course. And you can see on the right-hand side that all the key metrics in the year have shown improvement. And as well as that, we've also had two very good acquisitions, one in October of 2021 and one in July of 2022. So again, I'll touch on those later on. But in general, this shows great progress against the strategy that we set out this time last year. We're on track to deliver our financial targets because we've got those right foundations, that right culture in the business, and the market outlook remains very, very good for the markets that we operate in. You can see on the right-hand side that in the year through to June 2022, our revenue was up 10%. More importantly than that, our divisional margin was up 40 basis points to 2.4%, and that's as a result of the quality of contracts coming through the order book starting to impact the results that we're now reporting, as well as investment in better contract delivery. That resulted in pre-exceptional profit before tax of £19.1 million, which is 68% up on last year. And that translates into strong earnings per share and dividend per share, earnings per share up 68%, dividend per share up 70% on last year. And the exceptional items that I refer to, those are about investments in the business, one about an acquisition of a new business that we took out of administration, and the second is investment in digital infrastructure for the business to really support our growth as we go forward. There's no contract performance, no adverse contract issues at all below the line, or indeed within the results as well. And those strong results, of course, were delivered in an inflationary environment. So inflation, as you know, started to spike about this time last year, and we've been able to mitigate and manage the impact of that inflation in exactly the way that we said we would when we set our strategy this time last year. You can see in those results that inflation hasn't had an adverse impact at all. Our balance sheet, Sarah referred to, remains very, very strong and very resilient. So we had average month-end cash of £174 million in the year to June, and that combined with our PPP assets of £48 million gave us a £221 million of assets on an average basis through last year. We've got no debt, we've got no defined benefit pension schemes, and this strong balance sheet is a real differentiator for our clients and for our supply chain. We now pay our supply chain on average in 25 days. So a really strong performance working with our supply chain. Importantly, our capital allocation policy is unchanged. We absolutely prioritize retaining that strong balance sheet. That's very important for us to grow the business, to deliver our strategy. It's important to allow us to invest in the business, to invest in the adjacent market strategy, which I'll come on to in a moment, to look for bolt-on acquisitions where they are supportive and can accelerate our strategy. And of course, it provides protection in the event of any market downturn. And we're not seeing that in our markets at the moment. The strong balance sheet allows us then to prioritize dividends for our shareholders. And our dividend policy is that we'll pay a dividend twice covered by earnings. So 50p in the pound return to our dividend to our shareholders. And we've also said that we'll return any excess cash when appropriate to shareholders. So you put that together for the year ended June 2022, our dividend increased 70% to 8p. Our dividend cover two times as we set out. And we've also initiated a £15 million share buyback. And so that will be very earnings accretive as we go through the process of that buyback, which we started on the 21st of September. So with that backdrop of what we've delivered in the year just finished, what I now want to do is just talk about our strategy and how we go forward, how that strong culture and approach allows us to continue to improve and to grow the business. And of course, that's the essence of the investment case. So this is a very simple, straightforward overview of our strategy. Our strategy is to deliver high quality buildings and infrastructure in a socially responsible way, and to do that in a way which provides a sustainable return for our shareholders. And there's really four pillars on here that you can see. So the first is focusing on our people, delivering a progressive culture, making sure we get the best talent wanting to work and wanting to develop their careers with Galliford Try. And of course, doing that in a way which ensures that everybody goes home safely each and every day. Secondly, is about socially responsible delivery. So this is about social value, working with our local communities, local employment, local supply chain. It's about working in a way which addresses decarbonisation, biodiversity, water scarcity. And these are really important for the business. They're important because they are drivers for our clients, so they help us to win work. They're important for our people, so they help us to retain and recruit the best people. And of course, they're morally and socially the right things for us to be doing as well. We want to focus on quality and innovation to make sure we can deliver excellence for our clients. That's about digital investment. That's about investment in modern methods of construction. And of course, it's about investment working with the supply chain. And I've already mentioned that we pay our supply chain promptly. And we've got a program where we try to, for our key 350 suppliers are on our aligned supply chain, where we work very closely with them. They have access to our pipeline, to our training and so on. So we can make sure that we bring our supply chain along with us. And this year we've introduced, for example, our Net Zero Partners program, where we're helping our supply chain work on that decarbonisation journey and bring them with us on the decarbonisation agenda. And if we get those things right, then we will deliver sustainable, predictable financial returns for our shareholders, which of course is important for all of us. So this slide really shows us how we're going to deliver that. So the objective is sensible, controlled revenue growth, but more importantly, focus on margin growth. So we've set out our targets to 2026, growing the business to £1.6 billion revenue and 3% margin target. But of those, the absolute key target is the 3% margin. It's about the quality of the earnings, the quality of the projects that we are taking on, which is so important. So this schematic is intended to just show how we're going to grow the business. So we set the strategy up in 2021, which is the left-hand side. We've just reported the middle section, and we're looking to get to the 2026 targets. And we'll do that by growing in our existing markets, so our existing building business, which operates in schools, in healthcare, in justice, in defence, building social infrastructure across the UK. And there's opportunity for us to grow in those existing markets. In infrastructure, we operate in water and in highways. And again, both of those markets have great opportunity for us to grow. The highways business, we've got a great pipeline of work coming through the RIS program with National Highways and through local authority programs. And in water, there's increasing investment in water, clean water, wastewater treatment works. So we see our existing markets are able to grow in the current environment. And on top of that, we're looking to grow in three what we call adjacent markets. So these are markets that we know well, we understand, but they're opportunities for us to grow in higher margin parts of the market. So the first of those is in the private rented sector, PRS, where we already construct a number of private rented schemes each year. And we're looking to move into the development phase to source the land, to do the development, get the various planning consents, and then do the construction for our clients as we always have done. And we see that's when you look across the pieces, substantially increases the margin for us of those PRS schemes. We have a facilities management business which operates and maintains buildings. And we see the opportunity to move that into what we call the green retrofit market. So this is proactively going to buildings, surveying them to understand what interventions you can make on an existing building to improve its carbon efficiency, to lower its energy costs. And of course, that's particularly valuable at the moment, given where energy prices are. And we see this as a really, you know, particularly in the public sector, schools, hospitals and so on, as a real opportunity to make a big difference in terms of lowering the energy costs and the carbon footprint of those buildings. And in the water sector, we're very experienced at designing and building and commissioning water and wastewater treatment works. And we're now looking to move into the maintenance and optimization of those treatment works, which again is a higher margin part of the sector. And we developed some capabilities in this space when we did the acquisition in October 2021 of the water business of NMCN. So we see good opportunities to grow the business, and in particular to grow the business in a way which targets margin growth over the next 4 years. The market outlook is very, very resilient at the moment, and the market is there to support the growth that I've just referred to. So notwithstanding the current political uncertainties, there is a wave of opportunities. There's a huge pipeline of work. We turn away a huge amount of work at the moment. And the important point is that we don't operate in a cyclical sector. We operate in a sector which works in very long-term horizons. We're, you know, building schemes which might have a long gestation period and might be on ground for 18, 24 months. So there's a long, resilient outlook in terms of the sectors that we work in. And when you think about the sectors, you know, schools, you know, the demographics and the age and state of the school estate means that there needs to be continued investment in that space. Similarly with living accommodation in the defence space, similarly, we've talked about the water and wastewater treatment works continue to need investment. And those are driven by the regulatory environment rather than, if you like, short-term economic criteria. And similarly, in highways, the highways funding for the schemes that we're looking to deliver is already in place and is already there with National Highways. So we see a strong market and very resilient to what we're trying to achieve. Importantly, the focus as we approach that market, as I started on, is all about risk. Risk is embedded in what we do, and making sure we've got that culture of risk awareness in our tendering process, in the contracts, is so important. So we focus and address the market with a real lens of risk management. And most of our work is now awarded on a split of quality and price, where quality is the most important component, maybe 80-20 or 70-30, balanced in favor of quality rather than financial metrics. And quality is the quality of our people, the quality of our track record, the quality of our sustainability or social value credentials, and so on. And so it's possible now for us to win not being the cheapest. And in fact, you know, a tender opportunity where it's lowest price wins is something which would be a real red flag for us, because that drives all the wrong behaviors. And we go to market based on quality in the first instance. That's a very mature way for the for our clients to procure, and it aligns very closely with our own risk management strategy. And what that leads to, when you put all of that together, is a really, really high quality order book, £3.4 billion. That gives me 90% visibility for this year. It gives me about 65% visibility for next financial year, and probably about 30% visibility for the financial year after that. So I've got a really long line of sight. But more importantly, every single project in that order book is the kind of project that we can deliver day in, day out. It's all got the right risk profile. It's all got the right terms and conditions. It's all got the right technical capabilities. So that's really important. That means that that order book supports the margin aspirations that we have as a business. You can see that order book on the right-hand side there. 94% of that is with repeat clients, and 90% of it is secured through frameworks. And these frameworks give me long-term visibility of the future pipeline. They give me established terms and conditions to work on. And importantly, in our building business, the median contract is less than £20 million. And what that means is there's no individual contract in that order book that, if it were to turn down, would have the potential to undermine all the good work on all the other projects. So we've got a real balanced portfolio of projects which we can deliver across the piece. We continue to have that order book largely in the public and regulated sectors, and we see those sectors continuing to invest for all the reasons which I've talked about earlier on. So to bring all that together, Sarah, we've had a really good performance in the year through to June 2022. We've got a really robust and confident outlook for the current financial year and for our strategy through to 2026, and we're on track with those financial targets. Probably in terms of the margin, we're probably slightly ahead of the trajectory through to 2026. And importantly, if we achieve the margin targets and the revenue targets, then our PBT will just about double from the PBT that we've posted in the year to June 2022. And of course, the dividend will increase to match that. So we're very confident in the future. We've got a really good business. Importantly, it's grounded on culture. It's grounded on really excellent people, client relationships, supply chain relationships. And that's what gives us the confidence as we move forward. And so, Sarah, I was going to leave the presentation there, and then we can take Q&A.
And it's all about people, people, people. Right at the beginning, you said you talked to us about the risk awareness, which is homogenous across the company. You're making sure that everybody gets home safe. You look after people across the board. Suppliers get paid within 25 days, which you're setting a bit of a gold standard there for the industry. And I'm not sure if you've mentioned this, but a one-off payment to all employees to cope with the cost of living challenge. And you're not one of the cheapest, but the order book is robust, so you're loved by your clients.
It's really important. So, Sarah, we do obviously regular employee surveys. During COVID, we did those just as well, just for site-based stuff. So the staff who had to go out of the home, you know, to make sure that they were feeling supported. We have an advocacy score of the business about 84%. We've got about 94% of our staff buy into the strategy and buy into the vision that we have for the company. And you're right, we try to look after our people, whether that be around mental health and well-being sessions that we do across the business, and invite families and partners and so on to join that as well. The cost of living payment, we gave it to about half our people, about 1,800 people. We targeted it to the lower paid, and that cost the business £1 million. It's the right thing to do to help people. It's in the current circumstances. We've just introduced this week, actually, to celebrate Menopause Day, our first menopause policy. So we're really focusing on making sure that we're a business which is very progressive, and a business where people want to work, because we want to attract and develop the best talent in the industry.
So here's me talking about the order book. The forward-looking order book is robust. Michael Conway wants to know about the best projects just gone. He says an impressive set of results. What was the most profitable project you worked on last year?
So all of our projects were profitable. So what we do, Michael, is we track all of our projects, of course, in compared to expectations, so compared to the tender, compared to the budget on individual jobs. And when you track those on a kind of scatter graph, it's actually a really narrow band, which is exactly where we want it to be. So most of our jobs are performing where we would expect them to be. We have some outperformers. We have a few which drop below that trend line. None of the ones below are material. Yeah, they typically kind of outweigh the ones which are above. So we have a whole mix. I mean, I'm not going to name an individual project, but importantly, what we have is across that portfolio. Yeah, I think the portfolio approach to our contracts is helps drive that certainty and that predictability of performance, which we're starting to generate that track record of doing what we said we'd do as a business.
So in terms of that business, I'm looking across the business. You've got building, highways, environment. Ian Clegg asks, what is the set of criteria that you use to decide whether to take on a contract or not?
That's a really good question, because that that goes back to the heart. If you take the right contracts, then you give yourself a great chance. If you take the wrong contracts, then of course you're on the back foot. So that contract selectivity is absolutely front and center. So first and foremost, we don't take any big fixed price or risk lump sum kind of infrastructure projects, the kind of things which in the past have got companies into trouble. So in our infrastructure business, everything that we do in infrastructure, so highways and water, is on a target cost reimbursable basis. So very good form of contracting. It aligns the incentives for the client and the contractor, which is great. So it means people work together to find solutions. But all of our jobs, Ian, go through what we call a bidding heat map. So the heat map has a whole series of risk criteria, from who's the client, have we worked with them before, what's their payment profile like, what's the geography of the job, what's the technical challenges, what's the terms and conditions, have we got the people, is that particular region already overstretched or understretched, a whole raft of criteria, as well as size. And if any of those criteria are red, then that job will come to the executive board for approval. So even if it's a real straightforward, simple, small job, but the geography is wrong, then that would come to the executive board for approval, along with, by the way, every job over £25 million in any event. And so we have this really holistic way of looking at risk and looking at contract selectivity. It's not just about size is a factor, but it's not the only risk factor. So we have this holistic approach to looking at risk. But I think for me, the really interesting thing is we've had that process in place now probably 4 or 5 years. So everything in the order book has come through that heat map process. And what's really interesting now is that our local regional managing directors are completely aligned in terms of culturally and risk appetite and what we're looking to do. So they don't, those projects don't come to the executive board for us to say no. The local business has the same outlook, so they will have already turned these things down. And clearly, we get some coming across our desk, but nowhere near as many as we did a few years ago, because there's such an alignment of interest. And all of the business has got the same incentives as myself and the chief executive. It's about profit and it's about cash and about ESG. There's nobody in the business who's incentivized on turnover. So these things all drive the right behavior. But that heat map, Ian, is absolutely kind of front and center in terms of that risk management process.
How defensive is your business strategy? Because I didn't sense any fear when you referenced the economic climate. I mean, since you and I last spoke, I feel as though we've entered times of austerity. So is your business relatively agnostic in times of as we're experiencing now?
I don't want to come across as complacent or blasé. We spend a huge amount of time monitoring the market. So, but the couple of things I'd say. So first of all, we have 90% of this year's work in hand when we started the financial year, 65% next year. So that gives us a good platform, a long-term line of sight. So we're not out chomping at the bit for jobs today to start tomorrow. That's not, that doesn't That's not the business model. The model is a much longer term play. Parts of the sector, so water, for example, you know, there's a huge pressures in the water sector at the moment, but those come, and those come from the regulator. You know, those are regulatory pressures, and the regulator is not going to stop the requirement for water companies to continue to invest in improving clean water and wastewater treatment work. So we see some good fundamentals which will drive that behavior. As I say, if you look in education, the demographics demand, you know, that we have, you know, that we continue to build schools and that we continue to replace, you know, the schools which need replacement. So of course, you know, there may be some short-term challenges, but typically, you know, the long-term frameworks and that long-term line of sight gives us a really good opportunity to plan the business. And of course, it's the same with our supply chain. Of course, again, we're very conscious to make sure that we are staying very close to our supply chain and making sure that they also are robust and resilient in the current climate as well. So yeah, we're not immune to the world we operate in, clearly, but this is not a kind of front cyclical sector. In that sense, it's, you know, it is a relatively defensive sector.
I'm just thinking about the potential opportunities that may emerge due to distressed asset sales, good businesses, but unfortunately they've fallen in hard times. You have made, I think it's two acquisitions over the last 12 months. One of them was for £1. So I'm just wondering, more acquisitions to come, and will there be more than £1?
So possibly is the answer to both questions. So look, our strategy does not require us to do acquisitions. So we're not, we don't have targets there which are dependent on something outside of our control. But we're very alive to the opportunity for bolt-on acquisitions, particularly in that adjacent market space, which can accelerate the strategy, that can add capabilities to the business and be margin enhancing for the business. So the two acquisitions that we've done have been excellent, both in the water sector. So NMCN gave us both geographic infill, but also additional capabilities in the capital maintenance part of the market. And so post that acquisition, we now work for all the major water companies across the UK. And then that capital maintenance part of that business also came with an asset optimization, a factory which builds chemical dosing plants and water treatment control panels. And the second acquisition we did for £1 in July is another factory which builds, again, those motor control sensors for the water industry. So that's starting to give us a real critical mass in terms of that offsite manufacturing capability and that capability for improving the asset optimization in the water sector. So we'll continue to look for bolt-on opportunities which align to our strategy. They may be, you know, for £1, they may be for more than £1. Yeah, but that, importantly, the strategy doesn't require us to make acquisitions in order to hit those targets.
So in the next 6 months or so, let me see. So your year end is June, so you've got at least another 9 months to enjoy. So what's going to be happening over the next 9 months then?
Well, look, we're very well set. So we've got, obviously, our half years will be out in March, and then the full years will be out in through to June. So we're very well set for this year. Yeah, we'll continue to invest in our people, to continue to invest in graduates. We're taking more graduates, more apprentices, more trainees this year than ever before. And that's really important. That brings through our own pipeline of talent. It's generally a more diverse intake than the rest of the business, which is great. We've got, a negative gender pay gap for our early careers, which is great. So we're starting to continue to invest in our people. We'll continue to invest in our digital assets, our digital capabilities. That's about quality, it's about efficiency, it's about getting things right first time. And we'll continue to invest in our low carbon credentials. That's a real driver of opportunity, particularly for people like the Department for Education. If you can't build schools with a low carbon footprint, then you can't build schools for the Department for Education. So we'll continue to push hard on that agenda, which is really important, as I said earlier, for our clients and for our people, as well as being the right thing to do. So it's more of the same, Sarah, and it's really delivering and being focused on the strategy that you can see on the slide there to make sure that we continue to deliver predictable results. And that's what we're all about, doing what we said we're going to do.
More of the same. No, you'd normally associate that with boredom, but not at all. In your case, it's just continuing to strive to do your utmost best. Thank you very much indeed. And yeah, that the most recent results are testimony to all those efforts. Really appreciate your time. Thank you very much indeed, Andrew. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, Sarah. Take care.
And thank you very much for all your questions tonight. So unfortunately, it looks as though it's going to be more of the same in terms of UK politics. You can now go back and catch up. We'll find out who else has resigned from the government. But thank you very much indeed for spending some time with us. I'm just going to quickly highlight some of the fantastic opportunities to meet chief executives in person with Proactive next month, November the 24th at the Chesterfield Hotel in Mayfair. We're joined by Rambler Metals and Mining, Mosman Oil and Gas, Lavras Gold Corporation, and Canada Silver Cobalt Works. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you very much. And thank you to Thomas Coleman, our Global Events Director. Without him, none of this would be possible. Take care. Bye-bye.